Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you both for being here. Dr. Hill, when we last left July 10th, I believe Ambassador Bolton said to you, you go and tell Dr. Eisenberg that I am not part of whatever drug deal Sondland and Mulvaney are cooking up on this, and you go tell him what you heard and what I've said. That's correct, is that right?
That's correct, sir, yes.
And John Eisenberg, he's the chief lawyer for the National Security Council, correct?
He is, yes.
And you went to see him?
I did go to see him.
And what did you say to him that day?
I basically gave him the same summary that I've given to you on the 10th of July.
Of what took place?
Of what took place, correct. Including some of the details that I shared with you as well, the sequencing and what transpired as I was walking in.
Now, did you have one or two meetings with him about that?
He did not have a great deal of time on the 10th, and I gave him the quick summary, and we agreed that we would meet again on the 11th, on July 11th, the next day. And I also wanted to bring in with me my colleague, Wells Griffith, our Senior Director for Energy, who'd been sitting with me on the sofa for the first portion of the meeting. And I also suggested that he speak to Colonel Vindman separately as well, because Colonel Vindman was in the wardroom when I arrived and had obviously been engaged in some discussion before I got there, because as I got into the room, they were clearly in the course of, sorry, with the microphone, clearly in the course of conversation. And I thought it was important for John Eisenberg to hear from Colonel Vindman himself what his recollections of the meeting were.
Did you raise the concerns that Ambassador Bolton had raised to you, to Mr. Eisenberg?
I certainly did. The first thing I related to him was exactly and precisely what Ambassador Bolton had asked me to.
In the course of those two meetings, what was Mr. Eisenberg's response?
Mr. Eisenberg took it all very seriously. He said, for example, that Colonel Vindman should feel free, he said this to me, in future to go and bring any concerns to him about these meetings. Similarly, myself and any others, if there was any subsequent follow-up in terms of these issues being raised again with any of the parties in the future.
He didn't say anything in response about how he took that meeting, how he would describe it, or if he had any, did he raise any concerns about what you told him that took place?
No, he did not. He listened very carefully to all of the information that we imparted.
Now, back to that July 10th meeting, the second meeting that's in the wardroom, correct?
That's correct.
Now, who's in that meeting besides yourself, the two Ukrainians?
Mr. Danilyuk and Mr. Yermak, Mr. Yermak's aide, Ambassador Volker, Ambassador Sondland, and then a couple of people who I think were from the State Department. I wondered for a while if one of Secretary Perry's group had been there too.
But,
I honestly cannot remember.
But Ambassador Volker was there during that entire session.
He was there, but he didn't actually speak very much during that meeting. And I heard his deposition, and I read his deposition, where he didn't really recall that encounter. Again, he didn't really speak. Ambassador Sondland was doing most of the speaking.
Yeah, and as you, I think you described it as you came in. Ambassador Sondland was talking about how he had an agreement with Chief of Staff Mulvaney for a meeting with the Ukrainians if they were going forward with the investigations. While this was taking place and afterwards, how were the Ukrainians reacting to what was being said?
Well, at the time, Mr. Yermak was quite impassive. I said that he had an aide with him, and his aide was sitting next to him in the original meeting with Ambassador Bolton and was, you know, from time to time, actually was on this side whispering to him. So I wasn't sure myself, because I had not met Mr. Yermak before, about how good his English was. So I wasn't sure, perhaps Mr. Holmes might be able to reflect on that, as to whether he was, you know, having some points of clarification from the aide.
He understood what was happening.
Yeah, so I wasn't entirely sure if he was following all of the back and forth. Mr. Danilyuk, who I know very well and speaks very good English, looked quite alarmed. I think he was more alarmed at the fact that there was this back and forth between Ambassador Sondland and Colonel Vindman than with me about the meeting. Clearly, they very much wanted to have this meeting, and here are some U.S. officials arguing about the meeting in front of him, and that was obviously very uncomfortable for him.
Did you have any follow-up to that, sir?
I just add that Danilyuk speaks perfect English, and Yermak can get by in meetings, but often does ask for clarifications.
Given the time, I would yield back.